The last part of this deals once again with creating diversity. And when you create diversity, what you do is you change a little bit of that genetic material. So a mutation is a permanent change in the nucleotide sequence of DNA. And so what you do there is you physically change the letters in the words of the language of the nucleic acids. So that's what a mutation is. It's like taking your eraser and either cutting a letter out or putting a different letter in. Now, as we saw from the genetic code, if you have a mutation and it exists in the third position, then it may not make any difference at all. Remember what I said when I had, okay, as long as you have C and C, then any of them will work. It'll give you the same thing. So there's a lot of this redundancy in the code. But the first or the second one, that's where it makes a difference. So here's an example of this. This is normal hemoglobin DNA. And it turns out that hemoglobin is one of those where just a very small change causes a kink in the molecule. And instead of making a normal, nice, rotund red blood cell, it makes a sickle cell. So normal hemoglobin looks like this. The sequence is CTT. Mutant hemoglobin DNA is CAT, C-A-T. And so what's the difference? Well, it's a small difference. It's only a difference in a single amino acid. On the left, you have GLU. On the right, you have VAL. But it sure makes a big difference to the people who have sickle cell anemia. So that's an example of a mutation. And of course, this kind of mutation can be heritable. It's not just something that happens to you. If it's in all of your DNA, then clearly that's what gets passed on. Now, there are two main categories of mutations. One of these is what we call a single base substitution, which only have a limited effect. Single base substitutions would include changes where only a single amino acid is altered. So here you can see that the G above is turned into an A below. Now it depends on what exactly this does, where in the protein it is positioned, and then where this is. Now if you have a protein and you know it has a very complex structure and you know three dimensions and blah blah blah, and you have a little bit of a change right at the end, it's probably not going to make any difference. So even though you make a change like this, there could be no difference. But if you do it right in the middle, and it then kinks the entire molecule, that's obviously significant. Secondly, you have insertions and deletions, which are much more significant. And the reason why is because if you are inserting or deleting one thing, then it changes the entire sequence. So here we're taking out this one, right? That's going out. And then all of these shift. They shift one over. That means from that point forward, everything is different. See, all of these are now different. And again, if this happens right at the end of a protein, maybe it makes no difference, but it happens in the middle, it may inactivate the protein or make an entirely different protein. So clearly that's a very significant thing. But the reason why you do this is because our mechanism that makes amino acid chains doesn't just jump over these. It reads them in triplets. So it reads this one, great. It reads this one, well, it may have moved up into it. And so as a consequence, that little change makes a huge difference and you end up with an entirely different reading frame. Imagine leaving the sentences in your paragraph unchanged, but taking out one letter somewhere and moving everything over one, but leaving the spaces where they used to be and leaving the periods where they used to be and so on. It'll start to be like gobbledygook. It's the same problem here. Now, when you look at mutations, you find that the substitutions fall into three categories. These ones include the silent mutations. Silent means no change to the amino acids, so in this case, it doesn't matter. It is a mutation, but there's no net effect. One amino acid swapped for another, that's called missense. Missense mutation, therefore, is something that you do see, and maybe it's a small effect. Except for when you have things like hemoglobin, where it just happens at a crucial point. Nonsense mutations is where the amino acid codon changes to a stop codon. So that means you have your amino acid chain, and then suddenly it's cut short. So this can have a very serious effect. In fact, that can have as serious an effect as an insertion or a deletion, because you end up with everything normal and then the entire thing is gone. Likewise here, everything is normal up to the one point and then everything else is different. So those are the different types of mutations. Now you put that all together, again, once more, in addition to what happened to in meiosis, we are able to create some differences in the genetics. These are also unpredictable. Mutations happen, and some of them work, and some of them don't. So the vast majority of mutations are definitely harmful, but there are sometimes beneficial ones, and almost in every generation there's something that's beneficial, and that is why mutations are an important source of diversity. It may just be a color variation, hair color perhaps, one little thing. The color of what you see here, corals and algae, and of course, you know, it's the color especially is very interesting when it comes to diversity, because it sort of sticks out, comes out at you. But mutations are one of those things that drives biological diversity. And it obviously is one of those things that drives speciation and slight differences from one population to the next. And it will become important when we discuss ideas on evolution later on. So that's what we're going to do for today. And that's the end of chapter 10.